Hello everyone. This is Gurveen Kaur, Assistant Professor in Department of Management Studies. So today we are going to discuss the topic of History of Organizational Development and Foundation of OD. So basically, under the History of Organizational Development, we will be discussing the important stems of the OD. Now, four important front stems of the OD would be dealing with all those kind of research, all those kinds of action, all those kind of theories which have been created in organizational development, and upon whose we are taking the base of these theories, we are taking the base of these four stems to make further studies out of it. So we will be making them as a base, and we will try to solve the problem which is coming over there or we are facing in the organization. So it consists of, like a mangrove tree, OD have four important trunk stems. So first is the laboratory training stem, then the survey research and the feedback stem, action research stem, and social technical and socio clinical stem. So let's discuss the first one, laboratory training stem. The T group, that is the training group, it consists of the laboratory training stem consists of a training group that is known as a T group. It is an unstructured small group situation in which the participant learn from their own action. So a T group is a small group of the people who are over there that is unstructured. It is not structured. It is not formal. That is an unstructured one in which a situation is given to the people, to the participant, and they learn from their action in that particular situation. So what their action would be in that particular situation, they are going to learn out of it. Learn out of it. So the group of the people, they are going to learn from their own actions only. An intergroup relation workshop held at the State Teachers College in New Britain, Concord, in 1946, where it was discussed that the laboratory training stem was the most important one. Three group consists of the Kurt Lewis model, Kenneth Bannon, Lennon Bantrod, and Ronaldo Lippitt. So these were the four people who were involved over there, the five people who were involved over there, and they discussed upon the T group possibility and feasibility that how the people can learn from their own learnings. Next was Robert Tannenbaum. Some of the early sessions of what would now be called as the team building was conducted by him in 1952 and 53. So Robert Tannenbaum basically worked upon the team building action. So team building was the one of the possibility from which the people used to work in the group, and they used to discuss their own interrelationship among the people who are over there and in the organization itself. According to him, term vertical structure group are used with the group dealing with the personal topics as interpersonal relations and organizational topics as responsibilities, etc. So it was considered to be a vertical structured group in which they used to deal with the personal topics as the interpersonal relationship means they are going to consider their personal topics, personal issues, personal things over there that would be in an interpersonal relation, and organizational topics as the responsibility, and organization was the responsibility over there. Next was the Mac George. He was the first to talk about the transfer problem and to talk systematically about implementation of the T group skills in the complex organization. Now, how the T group skills means the T group, the people who are in the training, how they would be considered together and how they would be working over there. He, along with the other, established a small internal consultant group which used the behavioral science knowledge to help the line managers and their subordinates learn how to be more effective in the organization. So it established a small internal consultancy group which used the basic of the behavioral science knowledge which helped the managers and the subordinates to learn how to be more effective in the organization. Now, Mac George basically worked on the concept of the T group in which they used to talk systematically and the implementation of the skills in the group. Now, this would help to help to the manager and the subordinates to learn more out of the effective group, like how to work in a group, how the group coordination can help, how the teamwork can happen. So this was all based on the McGeorge study. Next, Herbert Shepherd and the Robert Blake, after initiating a series of the 2-week laboratory, they started with the laboratory which ended for 2 weeks. They emphasized on the intergroup as well as the interpersonal relationship. Now they basically emphasized on two things: intergroup, the relationship between the group members, and the interpersonal relationship between the members of the group. Intergroup would be between the different groups and inside the group itself. Although working on the interpersonal problem affecting the work performance was clearly an organization effort. So that was an organization effort that was basically done to improve the organization. So that was used for the organization effort. But between the groups, problem solving had even greater organizational development implementation because it involves a broader and more complex segment of the organization. So it used to be a greater organizational development implementation because it involves both a broader and the more complex segment of the organization. So it was into a wider term. It was a complex segment of the organization which was used to be work on the group basis, and the problem was solved on the greater organizational part only. So that was with the Shepherd and the Robert. So this was the first step of the organizational development history. Next step is the laboratory training step. Next step is the survey research and the feedback step. It is the specialized form of the actual research. The history of this step resolved around the techniques and approaches developed over a period of years. So this step is going to work upon the survey research. We are going to do the survey where the problem is, how the problem can be resolved. It is the feedback is collected from the people, from the organization, and upon those feedback, the actions are being taken. So that is related to the survey research, the research which is going to come out of the organization, and the feedback. Now, Survey Research Center was founded by the Risen Lickert, who is also famous for giving his 5-point rating scale and also known as the Lickert scale. So he has given a 5-point rating scale, giving the least number and the maximum number, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So rating is given over there. You need to rate the people according to, you need to rate the problem, you need to rate the features. So that is the rating scale, and that scale is known as the Likert scale. Third stamp is the action research stamp. It is a collective client consultant inquiry. Out of the 5 versions, the participant action research is used most frequently in OD. So it is a collaborative client consultant inquiry. Client consultant inquiry means I am the client and the consultant is coming over there to solve my problem. So action research stamp is used to solve the collective problems over here. Out of the 5 versions, the participant reaction research, action research is used more. So it is dealing with the action research process. Next, socio-technical and socio-clinical STEM. Bjorn Rickman and the other had been involved with the 6-week North Field experiment at a military hospital during the World War II. In this experiment, each soldier was required to join a group that performed some tasks such as the handicraft, as well as discuss feelings and interpersonal relationship. Eric Priss in 1947 visited British coal mine and observed that the team that worked themselves have organized was different, and the result of the team approach was remarkable in the safety and the productivity both. So it was being clear in the socio-technical and socio-clinical stamp that when the people under the worst circumstances also when the people they are allowed to sit into their group, to allow to work in a group, and they jointly put their effort in the group, then the productivity is improved. There is a remarkable change in the productivity as well as the performance of the people when they are working inside the group. So next is the second generation OD. Now, second generation OD consists of organizational transformation, organization culture, learning organization, intensified interest in team, total quality management, vision and future search. So first is the interest in organizational transformation. Now, organizational transformation is the second order change which happened over there in the organization. So this second order change basically deals with a multi-dimension that deals with the organizational transformation, which will be multidimensional. It is going to happen in the multiple dimensions in all the aspects of the organization. Then at multiple level, top level, middle level, low level. So it is going to happen at all the levels. Then it will be a qualitative change. So the quality is going to change, not the quantity. We are not going to increase the quantity, but a quality would improve. The improvement in the quality is going to happen. Discontinuous. So it is the discontinuous one. A radical organizational change involved a paradigmic shift. So there would be a shift in the organization which is involved over there. Increasingly, OD professional distinguish between the more modest or evaluatory efforts towards the organizational improvement, such as transit, fundamental large-scale change in the organization, etc. So basically, this transformation, the organizational transformation, is going to happen into the organization, which will be at the different levels over there. Then further, it is going to change, it is going to put an effort upon the transit of the organization, and the fundamental changes are going to happen in the organization. That is, a large scale change is going to happen, not at a small level, but at a higher level. Next, interest in organization culture. So organization, now we will be talking of the organization culture, not the large scale change, but a small scale change is going to happen over there. Shefton, in particularly, had written extensively about the culture. He has devised the intervention to help the leaders and the employees identify those culture assumptions that will assist the organization in attaining its goals, and those has hidden goals to attain. Now, this organization culture is basically going to work upon with those interventions to help those people and the managers or the leaders, we can say, the employees, we can say, who are working in the organization, but they do not know where they want to reach. So, or they are not able to achieve their goals. So how the hindrance to the goals can be attained, how this hindrance can be improved, how they can attain their goals, how they can attain their, you know, destination, that is more important over there. So that is how the organization culture can be improved so that the people can work accordingly. The intervention may involve exploration of the artifacts, value and assumption, as well as use of the questionnaire to identify old norms and for new one. So they need to change, they need to identify with the questionnaire, with the use of the questionnaire, to find out the facts, to find out the assumptions that where the problem is and how this problem can be removed. So how from the old norms, the new form norms need to be worked upon. Next is the interest in the learning organization. Senge writes extensively about the importance of the system thinking and also about learning disabilities that plagues the organization. Now we need to understand that what is the problem? What are the disabilities? What are the problems? What are the issues in the organization that is going to affect the organization? That is making worst effect upon the organization, and organization is not able to work properly, not able to perform properly. Productivity is going down. Production is not happening. People are not performing. So these are the worst effect upon the organization. So that we need to learn out of that organization. Some of the learning disabilities faced by the organization are focused on one's own job with the little sense of collective product. Other is blaming enemy out of there. Second, develop the workshop, exercise and games to create the awareness of these disabilities. Now, what are the disabilities? Blaming others for some problem. Then, having a little sense of the collective bargaining, how the collectively product can happen, how the productivity can be improved. So, they are not able to work with anyone else. So, group work culture is not over there. So these are the issues which are coming over there, and we need to learn this from the organization to remove them and to improve the productivity of the organization. Then is the intensified interest in team. In the recent years, I've seen a widen and the deepening interest in the team, especially the high performing teams, cross-functional teams and self-managed teams. So to improve the organization, we must increase and we must encourage the teamwork, because working in the team is more effective way of improving the productivity and to increase and to enhance the profit and to enhance the working culture in the organization. Then is the T2M, that is the total quality management. The past decades have this sense of mushrooming interest in the total quality management. Mushrooming interest means they are going to create more interest. So increasing interest into this. Total quality is typically a company-wide effort seeking to install and make parameters a climate where the employees continuously improve their ability to provide a demand products and services that the customer will find a particular value. So total quality management is, it's basically the overall improvement in the product, providing the customer with the proper service. Then it must be the cost effective also. So we are going to consider each and every aspect over here so that we can improve the productivity of the organization. Next, it would be visioning and the future search. Now, next we will be doing with the visioning and the future search. In this approach, interventions has been designed to help the organization member look to the future. So that would be future oriented. We are going to look into the future of this. Marvin Webster, this board has developed a future search conference in which the organization member work together on the data by analyzing and drawing the conclusion for the future action step. So this is going to work for the future, that and what is going to happen in the future, what our vision would be. So visioning the organization, what our vision would be in the future. So what we want to do, what we want to achieve, where we want to reach, what position we want to have. So that would be coming into the future search. Next, the extent of application. So where, till what extent this is being applicable, to which extent it is going to happen. So business and industry are not the only kind of the institutions involved. So organizational development is not only required in business or the industry, but it is required anywhere else, from public schools to medical schools, social welfare agencies, police departments, government unit, all are using the organizational development intervention. The range of occupational roles that have been involved in organizational development is limitless, ranging from managers, soldiers, psychologists, teachers, engineers, lawyers, etc. They all are working with the extent of the organizational development. So that is dealing with the organizational development basically. So next we are going to discuss with the foundation of OD. So how the OD foundation was laid, how it was being worked with the organizational development. Now, in this, we are going to discuss the various models and theories which are involved into this. So first theory was given by the Kurt Lewin. Change is going to happen in the organization at the three-stage process. So that organizational change is a three-stage process. Now, Kurt Lewis stressed upon that if an organization wants to change, get themselves involved in the three stages. That is the unfreezing, moving, and refreezing. Now, these changes would be, unfreezing would be the old behavior which was being followed. Now, old behavior will be, in this stage, we are going to identify what all the problems were, why the organization was not working properly, where the problems used to lie. So all those things would call to be the unfreezed one, which are not open. They are in a closed way, and that is not a good situation. Then we want to make the changes. When we have identified where the problem is, now we want to make the changes out of it. So changes are to be made over there. So that is when we are prepared making the changes in an organization, that would come into the moving part. And next would be refreezing. Then when all the changes have happened, when the things have been changed, the improvement are over there, the people have accepted the change, the people have started working with the new culture, then it would be known as the refreezing. So the first stage would be the freezing the old behavior or the situation. Then stage two, moving to a new level of the behavior. And stage three would be known as refreezing the behavior at the new level. So when the things have happened into a new level, when the changes have happened, that would come into the new level part. At Gates session, modify this theory by specifically psychologically mechanism, by specifying psychological mechanism involving each stage. Later, Ronaldo Lippitt, Jen Boston, and Broke Wisley explained that this model into the seven stage model. So there were again the amendments which happened over there, the changes which happened over there by the different philosophers time and again. So the basic theory was with the Kurt Loewenbaum. Then Ralph Kilman, five critical leverage points or the tracks we can say for the organizational change. So these tracks were the culture track. Now the culture track was dealing with the information part and the information in the organization, how the people used to talk to each other, how the information is flowing in the organization. Do the people believe upon each other or not? Then the management skill track. Now how to deal with the tough task, how to deal with the complex problems, how these problems can be solved. So that would come into the management skill track. Then team building track, that would involve into the management skills, the team, the people who are working over there together. Then the strategy structure track, developing with the more new strategies, developing with the new plans, how the organization can improve, how the things can help in the organization. And then the reward system track, that is establishing the performance reward based system. So if something good has happened, then the promotion is there, increments are there, motivation is there, appreciation is there. But if something worst is happening, then demotion can be there, decrease in the salary can happen. So that would result into the either the positive one or into the negative changes. Now, so track one was dealing with the enhanced trust, communication, information sharing, etc. Track two was dealing with providing the new ways of coping with the complex problems. So how the old problems, the complex problem, the large problem, very large problem, how they can be solved into the parts, how they may be divided into the parts and that can be solved out of it. Then issuing the new structure and update the management skills. So how the management skills can be enhanced, how the skills can be changed. So a new culture can be adopted. Then developing the revised strategic plan for the organization. How the plan of the organization can be developed. New development of the revised strategy plan. So how the strategic plan can be involved over there. Then establishing the performance-based reward system. So providing the rewards for the positive or the negative thing. Next was the porous and the Robustron model of the organizational change. Now, organizational development intervention alter features of the work setting causing the change in the individual behavior, which in turn lead to the individual and the organizational improvement. So whenever we are going to put some change in the organization, it will lead to the change in the individual. So first the individual will change, and once all the individuals are changed, then the automatically a change in the organization happens. So if we want to make a change in the organization, we need to improve the individual behavior of the people. So individual change is more required over here. So Porus and the Robert Sturm model of the organizational development comes in this way. So an environment is there. So that is putting an effect upon the vision of the organization. Now this vision is going to ultimately affect the physical setting of the organization, the technology of organization, social factors and organizational arrangement. So the outer environment is going to impact the vision, and vision is going to impact all these four. So organization arrangement, goals, strategies and structure, policies and procedures are over there in the organizational arrangement. Then are the social factors. This one, it includes the culture, management style, informal network, individual attributes. So all those things would come into the social factor. Then are the physical settings. It would include the space configuration, physical ambitions. So where the people are going to sit, the space configuration is there. Ventilation, proper ventilation is there. Then the environmental changes, all those things would come into the physical setting. Then is the technology, that is the machinery, tools, what kind of softwares we are going to use, IT, information technology and job design, those things would all be included into the technology part. So this is a model which is dealing with the basic change in the organization and aspect of these four features. Next is the system theory. Now, organization are the open system in active exchange with their environment. So organization is considered to be an open system which is having the input, the and the output. And the in between the input and the output, what is happening? That is happening the processing, and that processing is out of that environment which is going to come over there. So that is being given by the system theory. It consists of socio-technical system theory that was given with Eric. An organization comprises of two interdependent systems, that is the social system and the technical system. To achieve high productivity and employee satisfaction, organization must optimize both the systems. So both the systems should have an optimum level. Change in one system affects the other system. So if the social system changes, then the technical also change. If there is a change in the technical, then automatically the social system is going to change. Next is the Burke-Littwin model of the organizational change. It consists of two order change, the first order change and the second order change. The first order change is the transactional change, that is a low level change that is not going to happen at the large scale, but only the fundamental things are going to be changed. Small changes are going to happen. And then is the second order change, that is the transformational change, where the whole of the transformation is going to happen. All the changes, the basic, the important changes are going to happen over there. Organizational development interventions directed towards the structure, management practices and the system, that is the policies and the procedures, result out of the first order change. So under first order change, basic policies, the procedures are going to change. OD intervention direct towards the mission and the strategy, leadership and organizational culture, result in the second order change. When the main things are going to change, that is the mission and the strategy, leadership, the how the organization culture is going to change, when the major changes are going to happen, that would come into the second order change. Next is the participation and empowerment. Participation is when the people are allowed to participate into the organizational change and the organizational development. How the problem can be solved? When the maximum people are involved over there so that they can put their efforts into it to solve the problem. So participation in the organizational development program is not restricted to the elites or top people. It is extended broadly throughout the organization. So it is going to happen in the whole of the organization. The people from all over the organization, they can participate. Increased participation and empowerment has also been central goal and the fundamental value of organizational development. Participation enhances empowerment, and empowerment in turn enhance the performance. So when the people are allowed to participate, when they are allowed to speak, then they are going to improve their empowerment. And in turn, the empowerment will lead to the improve in the performance. Empowerment is the key to getting the people to want to particular end situation. Want to participate in a particular change, how to participate in a change, how to participate in an organizational policy framework. So all those things, the empowerment will lead the people to work about on these changes. Next is the teams and the teamwork. The characteristics of a successful team is clear, elevating goals and accomplish them. Result-driven structures, competent members, unified commitments, collaborative climate, standard of excellency, external support and recognition. Many tasks are so complex that they cannot be performed by the individual. People must work together to putting those empowered individuals into the team, creating extraordinary efforts on the performance. Team creates synergies, that is, sum of the efforts of the team is far greater than the sum of the individual efforts. A number of the OD interventions are specifically designed to improve the team performance. Example, team building and quality circle. Now, it is very much clear from this that if the people, they are working in the team, then the effort of everyone would be included into the team and that team is going to perform much better than an individual person. So when the people are working in a group, when the people are working in a team, they will perform better, the productivity will be high, the productivity will be improved, and that will lead to the high performance as compared to the performance of an individual person. And what all is required in the team, that would be the clear goals, clear vision, how to accomplish these goals, then result is expected. So it should work upon the structure, that is the result-driven structure. Then competent members should be there. Unified commitment should be there. Commitment, the people should be committed that yes, we will work for the same. Then collaborative climate. So collaboratively, everyone is going to work in a cooperation. Standard of excellence and the external support and recognition. External also, we are getting the support out of it. Next is the parallel learning structure. So parallel learning structure is also known as the community of the practice, promotes innovation and the change in the large bureaucratic organization while retaining the advantage of the bureaucratic designs. So we are going to work over here in a parallel form. So parallel learning structure would work with the practices that involves the innovation also and the change in the organizational bureaucratic organization. So we are going to work with the innovation. Innovation means the new inventions, the new changes which can happen. And these changes are going to make the change in the organization as a whole. Groups representing various levels and the functions work to the open new challenge of the communication outside of and the parallel of the normal hierarchical structure. Parallel learning structure may be known as the knowledge management. So parallel learning structure is basically dealing with the gaining with the organizational knowledge. So where the changes can happen, what new changes can happen, what kind of communication can be used. So we need to work upon all those things and we need to gain the knowledge related to this. Knowledge management involves capturing the organizational collective expertise wherever it resides. In database, on paper, or in people's head, and distinguish it to the people and distribute it to the people who need it in a timely and the effective way. So knowledge management system is capturing the expertise of the people in the various fields. So we are going to get the expertise knowledge from the different fields and compiling that expertise knowledge to work for the improvement of the organization. So we are going to collect the knowledge from everywhere. A parallel learning structure consists of the steering committee and the number of the working groups that study what change are needed, make recommendations of the improvement, and monitor the change efforts. So a parallel learning structure would consist of a steering committee, which will consist of the members from the various fields. So they will check where the organization is facing a problem. So problem will be recognized. The changes, how the changes can be made, that will be learned over there and the changes will be implemented. idea group, action group, implementation of the groups, etc. are involved in the parallel learning structure. One or more top executive should be the part of the steering committee. So top level people are included into this. Representative from all the parts of the organizations are also there. So from all the departments, from all the level, that is the top level, middle level and the low level, the representative from all the levels, they need to be present in that steering committee. A steering committee, what it will be doing, it is going to work upon the recommendation that where the changes can happen and how the improvement can be done. When to use it? When we are going to use the parallel learning structure? To develop and implement the organization-wide innovation, means invention, the new change. To foster the innovation and creativity within the bureaucratic system. So in the bureaucratic system, we are going to put a creativity and we are going to change that system. To support the exchange of knowledge and expertise among the performance. So how the knowledge can be used, how the expertise can be involved over there so that the changes may happen. To capture the organization collective expertise. So how we are going to capture the expertise, the experience, the expertise, the expert people, how we are going to gather their knowledge, how we are going to work upon this expertise. Next is the normative reductive strategy of change. Norms from the basis for the behavior and change among those re-education in which the old norms are discarded and replaced by the new norms. So normative reductive strategy is when we are going to reduce the old norms and we are going to involve the new norms over there. We are going to reduce the old strategies and new strategies are being used over there. The change in the normative orientation involves the change in the attitude, value, skills and relationship. So overall, in the four aspects, these changes are going to happen. That is the attitude of the people, value of the organization, value of the resources, skills of the people, and the relationship among the people. Norms can be best changed by focusing on the group, not the individual. So we will be talking of the group. We will be talking of a team, neither a single person or the individual. Applied behavioral sciences, organizational development is an application of the behavioral science. So this is going to work purely on the behavior of the people. It would consist of the pure or the basic sciences, applied sciences, generating knowledge and the knowledge to solve a practical problem. So we will be dealing with basically it would be all dealing with the sciences of the behavior and the knowledge which can be used and which can be generated to solve the problems. Practice theory, diagnosing the situation, then selecting and implementing the treatment based on the diagnosing and finally evaluating the effect of the treatment. So that would come into the practice theory. So we are going to practice the situation. We are going to diagnose the situation and then select the treatment. Which treatment will be properly implemented on the problem and so that the problem can be solved. Next is the action research. Data collection. Action research would consist of the data collection, feedback of the data to the client system members. Then it would include of the action planning based on the data, taking the action, evaluating the result of the action. So in the action research, the first would be the data collection. We are going to collect the data. Then the feedback of the data to client system members, then action planning based on the data, taking that proper action and evaluating the result of the action. So we are going to evaluate the result of that particular action out of it. Now it would consist of the what type it would consist of. It would consist of the diagnostic, participants, empirical and the experimental part. So diagnostic would be, we are going to diagnose the problem. We are going to diagnose where the problem was. We need to get the, we need to get the problem diagnosed over there. So what is the problem? We are going to find out the problem in the diagnostic part. Then participants, here in the participant, we are going to involve the people so that they can give the inputs. that where the problem was. So taking a proper action over there. Then empirical, the research that would be the systematic study would be consist of, then the problem will be solved and how this information can be used, and then would be the experimental part. So diagnosing would be the researchers enter a problem situation, diagnose it and make the recommendations for the remedial treatment. So recommendations may not be put into the effect by the client group. Then participant, people who are to take the actions are involved in the entire process from the beginning, involving the increase the likelihood of carrying out of the action once decided upon. Then empirical, researchers keep the systematic extensive record of what he or she did and what effect it had, may encounter the situation to deliberate from the one another, which may not permit generalization. Then the experimental, it is a controlled research on the relative effectiveness of the various techniques. It is difficult to do when the client want immediate answers. So that would be the experimental one. So experiment would be done over there. So that was dealing with the action research. So that's all for today. Thank you everyone for patient listening.